everybody. So welcome to the very first annual Knowledge Graph Technology Showcase. You might be asking yourself, why is there a showcase? Well, I often get the question, which tool is right for the job, especially when I am dealing with knowledge graph and modeling questions. And what I would like to do is share with you some tools that I often point people to, some that are new on the scenes, some that are going to be a surprise. And before you ask, none of this is sponsored. I have not been paid to do any of these. I reached out to everybody on my own time. They were kind enough to meet with me and film these. So I hope that these honest reviews, all of these are my own opinions that I often help people with when they ask me questions. I hope this helps you in your search for the next knowledge graph technology that you want to dive into a little bit deeper. All of the vendors that I'm going to be talking to, I have more information and their contact information in the description below. And if I missed any tools that you wanted to see me review, or if you have questions about the ones that we are reviewing, please leave them in the comments below. I and the people that I'm talking to will be able to answer those questions for you. All right, and so what is the criteria that I'm going to be walking through? There will be a summary at the very end of each video describing the answers to each of these questions, as well as a summary of any other little tidbits that we find out. So the main things that I ask are, what are the use cases that the tool is usually or best suited for? Also talking about that, what features do they have to actually support those use cases? That's pretty important in understanding if they're going to meet your needs. The other thing I like to talk about is what kind of data, what kind of format, and what kind of query language does the tool support? Two additional things I talk about, because I think they're pretty important, is first, interoperability. If a tool is not interoperable, sometimes it's a make or break moment. Other people don't mind if it's not interoperable. So we will certainly see people on both sides of the coin in these reviews. The other part is this SaaS or not? A lot of people that have small development teams or no development teams don't have the resources to set something up that's not SaaS. So I will be asking these questions as well as many more. So please join me in the next few episodes. So with that, let's check out this video's tool of choice, which is... All right, and with that, let's go kick it off.
Sure, sure. My name is John Herkey. I'm the technology evangelist here at Tigergraph. My primary job is really about engaging the developers and helping developers out and getting the community built and helping everybody in the community with all their different projects. But my background is actually in computer networking engineer. I was in the military for 8 years. I go out in the middle of nowhere, shoot up to a satellite, grab an uplink, deploy a network, program routers and switches. Went to go work for a big company called United Health Group and worked in their data centers. Got a little bit bored of doing networking because it ended up being a little bit of like copy and paste, a huge enterprise. And so I actually transitioned from the networking world, staying in the same company, to becoming an entrepreneur in resident. And so our sole focus was looking at these emerging technologies and figuring out how do they fit into the healthcare space? How can we improve the healthcare space by leveraging these emerging technologies? And of course, coming from the networking world, I gravitated towards graph right away.
Yeah, of course.
So I put back on my developer hat and started building on different graph solutions. And there's many more stories we could talk about that, but that's briefly into my history. So I would love to give an overview of our products and solutions. This is actually Tigergraph Cloud. This is a Tigergraph operated software as a service. And essentially what you can do is you can provision a box and you can do that for free. So if you actually went to tgcloud.io, already there, you would be prompted with a login screen. So you would simply log in and you'd land somewhere like this on your dashboard. So the dashboard is just an overview of some of the boxes that you have. Of course, I do a lot of demos. So I have like a bajillion boxes. Yeah, bajillion boxes. But I did spin one up today because it takes about 1 or 2 minutes for it to actually spin up. But I'll walk you through how you can spin up your own solution, and it's all free. So you just go over to the right hand top corner after you log in, and go to My Solutions, and then what you have here is a bunch of toolkits. And so let's say you want to explore maybe how to do COVID analysis or how to do customer 360 or movie recommendations or recommendation systems, or maybe you want to get into some fraud, or maybe you want to get into some supply chain.
You don't want to get into fraud.
if you want to understand how to analyze fraud using Graph Solutions, there's already a kit for you built that you can actually get up and go with it instead of, how do I build this and how do I come up with this and this and that? So it's just a great place to start. Yep.
Yeah, and I love this because so often even the solutions that have some open resources that you can play around with up until, you know, a certain threshold of data, it's just, okay, now you have it, go play with it. And there's no, you know, starting point to see what does data look like in this thing unless I go and look at a demo. This is actually giving that to you to play with yourself and to kind of learn. And if you're the type of learner that wants to do and play in order to learn, I think this is a great place to start.
And that's to be honest, that's me. I just want to like get my hands dirty and be like, mess up all the time.
Me
and
then, too. I like then, to break it.
Yeah, exactly. And then I'll figure out, oh yeah, okay, I don't know how to do that. Maybe I'll watch a video and then figure it out. That's exactly how I learned. So what we're going to do is we'll just, you know, let's say I want to do fraud. I'll just choose one of these fraud toolkits. You have the option to do AWS, Azure, Google Cloud's not offered here, but if you're doing this outside of TigerGraph Managed Operation Cloud Services, you can provision it, and this is just operated by TigerGraph. But now, if you want to do the free version, which, you know, if you're getting your hands dirty, you would just want a box and you want to play around, you can have this box forever, all you have to do is simply click the free and choose where you are. Choose, you only get 50 gigs of disk space, but then after that, you just click next. You fill out your solution, and so you give it a name, you tag your solution, you give it a default password, and then you can give it a custom URL domain name. So this is the custom URL domain name is actually where the Graph Studio is going to be sitting. So there's a database, TigerGraph is a database. They have a tool or a platform, whatever you want to call it, GUI, on top of the database, and that's called Graph Studio. And so Graph Studio allows you to have a graphical user interface to accompany TigerGraph and to write queries and to analyze things and to do some schema changes. Of course, you can do all that through pure code.
Yeah.
But it just makes it really easy if you're just getting started to just, you know, be able to interact and do that through a GUI.
It's also really helpful if you're trying to sell a solution to your stakeholders that are not data people.
And so what you just do is click on application, and we're gonna actually go to the Graph Studio. Now you can download. I'm showing you the TigerGraph Cloud because it's really easy. You don't have to do any installations, downloads, or things like that. Here we are now in the Graph Studio, and we have a couple different tabs over here. And so the first one is the design schema, and so this is just how you're modeling your data. Mm-hmm. So you're going to be designing what are the different data elements, how do you want the different data elements to connect to other data elements, and that's really what the schema is about. You're just sort of architecting your database. Mm-hmm. The neat part about this versus relational database, let's say you have new data coming in and you might want to append something to your schema. It's very easy just to modify the schema, and you can do that without having to lose all your data and have to remodel. So there's a lot of different buttons. I won't go through all of them.
Yeah.
But you know, you could, if you were going to add a vertex, and this is pretty much how you would do it. Add the lines. You would edit. You can undo, redo, and then your settings. I won't click on them all, but feel free to check them out. And I can send a blog to you guys, and then what you can do is reference the blog, and it walks through all of this. So if you don't want to watch videos and you just would follow along a blog, I have a whole blog just on this. So
we can put that in the description below so everyone can access that.
Yeah. Yep. Of
awesome.
Course. And so we're in the global view. What's interesting about TigerGraph is it has the ability to have multi-graph functionality. And so what that means is maybe you have a patient in the healthcare space, and then you have this department that has its own graph, and then you have this other department that has its own graph, but they also have the same patient. And so what you can do with having multi-graph is actually having these overlap of graphs. So you're not having duplicated data.
In this case, you can connect the same user if they're in multiple graphs with an additional graph, which is pretty cool.
Yep, and all those graphs have separate access controls, and you can lock them down. If you want to go over here, you can check on this as well. So you have user management. You can lock users down based off roles, and you know different roles, different proxy groups. You can tie it to your LDAP. You can tie it to OAuth. Whatever you'd want to do, you could tie all that stuff together. And actually, a feature coming out pretty soon, so you guys get a sneak peek at it, is we're going to have down to the vertex level. We'll have security to every single vertex, and you'll be able to lock, that's ultimate fine-grained control.
That's amazing. That's so exciting. Congratulations. I think that's gonna be great.
Yeah, there's going to be certain use cases. Of course, you know, having that security level may slow down the speed a little bit, but if you're in that situation where you need to have that precision control of security, we have it for you. So we went through design schema. So next, what we're going to do is go through map data to graph. And so this will actually provide you we're in the GUI, so you can drag and drop and add files. So you can add, if you want to add your own CSV files or connect this to an S3 bucket or whatever way you want to get your data in. And this probably the easiest way is just dropping a file in there if you want to explore it. And then what you do, you add your file in here, and then what you can see is the connection. So how do you go from the tabular data, the CSV files, and how do you insert them into the solution? And so you can simply just click on, this one connects to that, and this is just mapping to where the data is going to be inserted into or upserted into the graph. So once you've designed your schema and said, okay, here's my data and this is my data pipeline and this is how the data is going to go in, then what you can do is actually load your data. So we're going to go to load data, and in this case I have no data right now, and so you see all my different files, and then we have a play button up here, and we're just going to click continue, and what it's going to do in the background is load all those files. And I think this is a relatively small solution, so it's a little bit smaller. So, but the basic principle is that you have this schema, you map, you have your schema, then you map, and then you load your solution, and then what you have now is a graph solution that you can explore. You can do what you want with it. You can start to write analytical queries. You can start to discover new things. So as this populates, I think we might be able to actually explore as it populates. Let's just see. Okay, yeah, cool. Awesome. So now, it's still loading in the background, but some data's in there. And so what I'm just doing is the explore graph feature. And so you can choose which vertices you want to do. Or explore, you can choose, maybe I want to start at this one and then maybe crawl along certain edges or expand towards certain vertices. So this adds the weaving through the graph, fine-tuned graphical user interface experience. Of course, this is just allows you to have that view on top of your database solution. Let's say you don't know how to really write the language yet, like you don't know how to write GSQL. One thing you could do is use the build graph patterns. And so instead of actually coding, you're just doing drag and drop, and then writing your query and using a GUI instead of writing a query. So if you're looking at this, you might be like, oh, I can read that. It's a select and a from. There are some interesting functions that you can do, and one of those is really these accumulators. So every time you're doing a pass, or every time you're doing a pass, so every time you're going across your graph, it's going to do a certain action. And some of these accumulators might be a sum accum, an average accum, and so you can do some of these calculations while you're traversing your graph, which is pretty powerful to have. But it's the GSQL. If somebody knows SQL, they can really get into GSQL really fast, to be honest. But the best feature about this GSQL and writing your queries is every time you install your query, I can click this button, but it's actually going to take like a minute, because what it's going to do is compile it, optimize it, and install it and generate a GSQL endpoint. So you're literally, you write a logic, and maybe your logic has a parameter that goes in the input, and then out the output is whatever you programmed it to do. So you're returning whatever you built into the query. But as soon as you run this install, what it's going to be doing is compiling that to an endpoint. So now you can go into your Postman or your data science book. You can
do big.
And you can instantly calling it. Like, you don't have to think about anything. You just wrote, okay, this is what it's going to do, and now I can use it. Then you have, I mean, this is an endpoint. So
yeah, there it is.
Literally, this is what I called it, an anti-fraud TG Cloud. And here's the query name, and it's accepting an input parameter of a user. And so you pass it, and it's going to output whatever it's supposed to output. So you can start to see like use cases without diving in too deep right now. You're just highlighting over solutions. You see that we have Customer 360. So customer 360 is really important. When it says customer journey, it could also be a patient journey. So, you know, working in the healthcare space, how can we tie all the pieces of an individual patient together in a journey? And why is that important? Before
it's general named entities, right? That would be able to be used for.
Yeah, I mean, you could do a product 360, a customer 360, whatever you want, something 360. But what is, so we have our graph solution was 58 billion connections, 10 billion nodes. We have 50 million patients, and we want to derive every single touch point that patient had with the healthcare system, every claim, every phone call, every prescription, everything that they had. And not only retrieve that in real time, but we retrieved it in 50 milliseconds, which if you think of a Google search is 200 milliseconds. It was just when people saw it, they couldn't believe it. So there's all these maybe 360 product 360, user 360. If you're Amazon and you want to build the next Amazon, you know, you probably want to see this user bought this, maybe that user bought this, and that. So you could build a recommendation engine and have 360.
Just a word of caution for those that are watching. This is the tech that will make that possible if your data is good and if you do all the steps leading into the powerful technology. So just a word of caution for anyone that's like, yeah, I want that, and your data is pretty messy and you don't know what's in it.
But I know you wanted to talk about supply chain. So I'm going to dive into just a little bit of supply chain. So if we want to just click on supply chain analysis, and we're going to go over to Jaguar Land Rover. Now, we have a bunch of these case studies. So if you want to see how actually people are implementing the solution into their business, now in this case, what they're going to do is implement it into supply chain. And I shouldn't say what they're going to do, they have already done it. And so what they're doing is, how can we mark down the whole supply chain from the manufacturing plants to the people, to the sales order, to the features. So let's say, you know, when COVID hit, there's a huge disruption in products getting to the right place because different places were shut down or manufacturing plants had to be shut down. So that was a huge impact. And so if you have a tool that has every single touch point of the supply chain, and you can reanalyze the supply chain in real time. Okay, this the shipment couldn't get to the manufacturing plant that, you know, puts the items together. What parts are there? How can we optimize the supply chain to maximize revenue while the shipment's not getting there? So okay, maybe we don't have the car parts for this, but we do have the car parts for that, and we'll put this car together instead of that car. You can start to do those in a very short time versus what they were doing before was about 3 weeks. It was, and now you have this ability to do it pretty instantaneously.
Yeah, and another aspect. So I actually worked on some graphs at Rolls Royce, and one thing that you also get with these kind of supply chain graphs is risk management as well, because your vehicle actually has more electronics in it than your typical spacecraft. True statement. So what happens is, if you don't know where those electronic parts are coming from, you might know the first hop away from you, that manufacturer. But if you don't know that manufacturer got certain chips from somebody else and they're not as secure, those chips actually could have threats in them that you aren't aware of if you don't have good supply chain management. So I think this would also help with all those touch points, being able to map back through exactly where each component comes from is very beneficial.
One new feature that they just at 1.0 is that you can actually do SQL. And so you can write, you know, SQL queries, and you can have input and output of SQL-ish type of data. Mm-hmm. And so that unlocks a couple different things. Of course, with SQL, you can only do so much because you know, you can do some selects, but you can't in group bys and those kind of things, but you can't do multi-hops. One of the neat features about graphs, if you don't know, that data scientists love, is that all the data is pre-joined. So imagine all your data pre-joined. So you're not actually having to join your data. All you have to do is crawl across your graph and select the data elements that you want to retrieve. Those are stored in memory, and then pop, and you pull them out, and instantly you have it. So you're not, you know, 24 joins.
So I have a whole video on why that is one of the biggest perks of going to graph. I'm going to link that up below if you missed it, because it is a huge deal, because having to do so many joins, I mean, that's the thing, right? Everybody talks about graph, and they say, if they're not, you know, in favor, I could do that in my regular databases today. Yeah, but you have to do so many joins and so many different tables that it gets very expensive and time consuming to do so. And why not go to the native connection structure, which is a graph, right? So I think that's one of the biggest perks.
Data is not going to be slowing down. Data is just going to be continuing to come out. So TigerGraph was smart from the very beginning. They architected their solution to be parallel processing and to scale horizontally instead of, you know, vertically. And that set them apart when they came into the space in 2017. So.
Yeah, and I think that you had mentioned, you know, things, right, instead of strings.
Yeah, 2012.
I think that's getting adopted more and more. And as there are more things in the world, that's just going to explode the data sphere even more so than we've already seen, which is kind of frightening in a way, because there's so much data already available. To make even more of it, I think lends itself to really people getting into this graph space, because it is native to that kind of framework, and it allows you to make sense of that chaos and all of that data. So I think that is a big reason that you're starting to see such an explosion in maturity in graph. Graph's been around for a while, but, you know, I think it's just recently, in the last few years, has really reached, you know, a pinnacle where people are really starting to adopt.
Yeah, especially with a lot of correlations and connections with different data elements. And I can give you an example of that. So, like, let's say, you know, somebody just got sick, and what's going to be the best, you know, treatment path for them as an individual, forwards. And so what you can do, because you have all your data stitched together, is you can say, okay, this person is this demographics, they have these preconditions, they have this background. So then I'm going to find and do maybe a cosine similarity algorithm to determine what are similar patients to this patient, and then look at their journey. Okay, so they both got sick of this. How do I then, this patient took this drug treatment path, this patient took that drug treatment path, what's going to be the best outcome for this patient based off all the data that I have available? And of course, this is not just, you know, siloed data. This is all interconnected, stitched together data. And to be able to have that just unlocks tremendous value to your enterprise. And
John, thank you very much for walking us through this. This is so exciting. I really do think this is one to watch, everybody. This is pretty powerful stuff. So, John, if anybody would like to follow you and listen in, because I think you have some things that you do outside of interviews like this, how would somebody get a hold of you?
Yeah, so I'd say the best way to get a hold of me would actually be LinkedIn. And so we'll put a LinkedIn connection in the description below, right? And don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment. No, so I'll plug for you. No, so yeah, outside of you know, TigerGraph, I also run a nonprofit called Futures Academy, which is really dedicated to bringing these emerging technologies to students. There's a huge education gap between our current system and what's going on in the actual world. And so what we're trying to do is bridge that education gap, bring these huge companies, and bring the technologies, the big technologies of the world, and actually give that directly to the students. Students are phenomenally curious and are passionate and trying to learn. We have YouTube University, of course, you know, that's where everyone goes to learn these days. And there's nothing that these students can do. And so we really want to provide them with just the awareness of these emerging technologies and let them go loose and have mentor systems tied to that. So feel free to check us out at futuresacademy.com if you want to learn more or reach out to me personally.